Wow, it's figured it out. All right, so we're doing this live thing here, and I'm working on...
Firefighters in the Atlanta area are being targeted by thieves. Since Thanksgiving, the thieves have been breaking into vehicles and fire station parking lots across the area while the firefighters are away on calls. Four fire stations in Gwinnett County have been hit. Okay. Spokesman Tommy Rutledge.
We're encouraging crews to keep a vigilant watch on their parking lots.
So we'll be back in just a moment.
We've
got to get
started. Police department in our jurisdictions to step up patrols in the parking lots.
Rutledge says at least one gun was stolen when vehicles in one parking lot were broken into. She did the grid in 1 year. Sue Johnston is claiming to have hiked every one of New Hampshire's 4,000-foot-tall mountains in every single month of 2016.
Wow.
It takes most hikers years to complete the grid, and while it requires hiking each mountain in each month, it does not require it all in 1 year, which is what Johnston is claiming she's done. And New Hampshire has 48 mountains of 4,000 feet or higher.
Looking sideways.
The state's hiking community tracks the challenge. It might be a preview of the Oscars. In Hollywood, they dish out the Golden Globe Awards tonight.
In the Best Motion Picture Drama category, you have Hell or High Water, Manchester by the Sea, Lion, Hacksaw Ridge, and Moonlight. In the musical or comedy category, it's 20th Century Women, Sing Street, Florence Foster Jenkins, La La Land, and believe it or not, Deadpool.
ABC's David Blaustein, the movie nominations at the Golden Globes Awards tonight. This is ABC News.
How's it going?
I'm having a stroke.
Are you going to shake my hand?
Don't have a stroke.
I'm having a stroke.
Wow, you're not even moving your arm.
I'm having a stroke. When someone is having a stroke, they may not be able to say the words.
But I got lots of things here.
Tell you loud and clear. Look for fast. F, face drooping. A, arm weakness. S, speech difficulty. T, time to call 911 immediately. Know the sudden
signs. Still working on getting
this to work. Stroke fast. Visit strokeassociation.org. Brought to you by the American Stroke Association and the Ad Council.
Now here we go. Drowning out with this. Good people of Columbia, I'm Gene Garris, and you're listening to AmericasRadioShow.com, first show of the year. Unfortunately, just because the way the holidays fell, the Feast of the Holy Nativity, that Christmas Day, that messed us up on one show, and then we lost out on New Year's Day. But on that New Year's Day, we jumped up, we moved on up, just like the Jeffersons. We got a much better thing. It's actually called a translator, but we're back at 100.7. That's 100.7 in my book, and also at 1470 AM, and also at 1490 in Cameron, South Carolina. So you can catch us in all of those things. You can always hit us at AmericasRadioShow.com and at MakeThePointRadio.com, and we're still streaming live at MakeThePointRadio.com and on the TuneIn app. So if you have an Apple religious pendant that looks like a phone or an iPad or whatever, you can listen to us there, and you can catch us on your Android device or even on your many flavors of Windows operating system, Windows mobile devices too. And what a great year this is already. Started to be. We're going to have King Trumpkin. We'll be there in just a little bit, just a couple more days. The whole world is spinning. I was reading just moments ago, that Jeep, Daimler Chrysler, and now it's a Chrysler Jeep, is going to create 2,000 new jobs. We have plants all over the place saying, oh, well, we were going to spend $1.6 billion in Mexico, but we'd rather spend $700 million here in America. So my question to start off with, a little question, it's really more of a statement, but if all it takes is a little bit of change in the culture, if all it takes is a phone call from the chief executive, or in this case, the guy that's going to be the chief executive, if all it takes is a little bit of scrutiny, why haven't we had any of that the last 7 years, 11 and a half months? You know, if all it takes is a tweet, if all it takes is 140 characters to get Boeing to cut the price of the new Air Force Ones, if all it takes is less than 140 characters to shame the Republicans in the House about changing the ethics rules as their first order of business, if that's all it takes, then long live Donald Trump and long live Twitter. I'm just amazed by how much in 140 characters, how much he has been able to do. And it's surprising and it's just amazing that he can affect, he can dominate the news cycle in those 140 characters. And it's a good year for a lot of people. Megyn Kelly did good. She's moving on over to that Peacock network, and she's going to do a whole bunch of stuff. And so her desire to slay the king, to defeat Donald Trump, didn't work out, but it paid off. Those are her bona fides, her bona fides that she was willing to go after Trump, first question out of the box. And so that's, if that seemed weird to you, and it seemed weird to me, with all the things that we could have talked about, that was her first question of Donald Trump. Now you know what it was about. It was really a contract negotiation tactic that she, by doing that, whether by hook or by crook, her agent maybe, her husband, her friends in the industry said, you need to do something big. You need to separate yourself from Fox News. You need to show that that you have some legs to do some walking around to make you more desirable in the marketplace. And that's probably what it was all about. Now, Donald Trump, of course, could have handled it better, but, you know, that's what you got, and she's got a new job with the Peacocks. So telephone number here is 803-799-8255. So we've jumped up on the dial a little bit to 100.7, but the telephone number is still 803-799-TALK. And I feel strange, you know, because it's been 2 weeks. Well, actually, 3 weeks is of time has passed since I've spoken to you lastly on a Sunday. And I'll be back on the air. I'll be back on Tuesday morning, I think the 22nd or 24th. I forget the date, but I'll be back doing the 9 to 10 slot, our potluck hour here every Tuesday on The Point. And just great stuff. And, it, you know, they talk about a way to start the new year, to flip the switch and jump higher on the tower, having more effective radiated output than we've ever had, and the signal is wonderful. And a friend of mine, and you know, he's one of your radio buddies, but is told me he was driving to Spartanburg, and he had heard the station all the way up to almost Newberry. So I think that's a big positive thing. And I've missed you. I've missed all my radio buddies here on The Point. And again, you can always catch me. You can send me an email, too. That's another thing. I will sometimes respond to emails, I get a whole bunch of them. So if you just want to shoot me one of them email things, you can go to the big thing is drgenegarris at alumni.clemson.edu. So tonight, actually, I'm going to Tampa. So after I'm done here and after I do some stuff, I'm going to Tampa. I'm going to go see those Tigers play. I was almost disappointed that Friday wasn't a football Friday on the afternoon drive, but I know how you Gamecocks are. And I hope as many of you as you can support. Clemson has to win this one for me. And the reason Clemson has to win this one, and then they need to rebuild a little bit, because I can't afford to do this every year. This is starting to get expensive. But I will go and see our good friends, all the good little Tigers, hopefully tear up Alabama. And it, you know, the last matchup was the best losing game that I had ever been to. The most exciting, anyway, losing game. And again, the telephone number here is 803-799-8255. And it might be a year of new beginnings. And this year has already started out to be okay. But 2016, and not just me, but I've got a whole bunch of personal things, people in my life that went to the great beyond this past year. 2016 was just a horrible, horrible year for a lot of folks, and a lot of, you know, we say, oh, well, look at all these celebrities that are dropping dead. I don't really care much about celebrities. Talk about the real people, the people that I care about. But so many people. And so many horrible things. And I posted a thing on that Book of Faces. As you might be watching me on Facebook Live right this second. And I said, based on our most recent and the last big party the Obamas threw, which was full of celebrities. And you know, people have said for ages, now, we're going to be back in just a minute, but politics is celebrity for ugly folks. Be back in just a moment.
Our website is mobile-friendly.
This magical technological age in which we live.
Load it now. MakeThePointRadio.com. Come up with us, local talk radio experience. The Point.
Now at 100.7 FM at 1470 AM.
I will not make any deals with you. I've resigned. I will not be pushed, filed, stamped, indexed, briefed, debriefed, or numbered. My life is my own.
And so as we were bloviating about just before the last whiplash break, our great president and his lovely wife and two kids will be leaving the White House, and they've been some moving vans already approaching the White House, and you know, they've got a lot of stuff to move. You know that's if you've ever gone to a presidential library and you're like, why do these people need a library? You know, in that world, almost everything is done by letter. You know, you and me as civilians in the modern age might think that, oh, everything's email and stuff, but a lot of it is done by letter and by email, and I mean, a lot of that's electronically transcribed now, but there are hundreds of thousands of millions of documents that an administration produces, because everything that's done has paper associated with it. That's just how it works. If you write if you say, I want this to happen, there's a letter. So, well, I think you need to look into this. There's a, you know, that's a page. All these things exist. And when Sandy Berger, I think he's a national security advisor to the Clintons, after the Clintons' time in the White House, when he raided the National Archives and stuffed things down into his underwear and smuggled them out of the archive to be destroyed or to never be seen again. Anyway, there's a reason for that. Now, I don't know what the reason is, but everything they do is documented on paper. So you say, gosh, why do we need a presidential library? And the reason is there's a lot of paper, and there's a lot of reason to have scholarship and to do things. So if you're a researcher, like there's a guy named Michael Beschloss, and he's written a number of books, and two books on Lyndon Johnson. Well, he went to the Johnson Library, and he listened, he read documents, and he listened to tapes, and he wrote a book about it, and excerpted in audio form, and also in text, things from the tapes of President Johnson. So you got to find out, you know, what was going on, and some of the stuff is inane, some of the stuff is borderline criminal. And some of the stuff is, you know, the everyday workings of the White House. And some of these personalities, you know, I would almost be willing. Actually, I would. I'll say it. I want the president to be taped 24/7. And if you say we're not going to be able to listen to these things for 50 years or 100 years or something, I think it has value. Because it will drastically change your opinion about how things work. So one of these things was President Johnson, the thing that's out in my memory, President Johnson was going to, he had called Sergeant Shriver, a guy that married into the Kennedy clan, had called him and said he wanted to make him head of the Peace Corps. And remember, this is the President of the United States, and you know, whether it's President Obama or President Nixon or President Johnson or President Kennedy himself, compared to the President of the United States, I'm a bug, you're a bug, everybody that's not the President of the United States is a bug. So here we have this recorded conversation of Lyndon Johnson and Sergeant Shriver. And President Johnson starts talking about, you know, I want to name you to this. And Sergeant Shriver sort of blows him off a tad. And President Johnson said, look, in 3 hours, I'm going to announce this in the Rose Garden. You need to be down with it. You know, this is me improvising a little bit. But you need to give me an answer. And he said, wow, I need to talk to the family. And President Johnson, you know, was like, this is your president calling and asking you want to do something. You know, and so I think there's value. I think there's value to having these jokers recorded and to hear. There's another conversation with President Johnson and Bobby Kennedy. They hated each other. And it's a very sort of weird how whiny, you know, and in American politics, Robert Kennedy, he's a, you know, an icon. He's a, you know, a martyred hero. But to listen to this exchange between President Johnson and Attorney General Bobby Kennedy was, I mean, so strange. You would never imagine that these two titans of American politics, that one of them would be so whiny. It's just amazing. So I think there's value to that. So I would support 24/7 recordings on phones and electronics and everything and tracking. Even if it required, you know, you had to say, we're not going to listen to it for 100 years, or, you know, nothing here can be, nothing acquired this way can be used for criminal prosecution or something like that. There is value to hearing how it really works. And it works a lot differently than I ever thought. So that was a big thing. So last year, for me, not a good year. Not at all. Not a good year at all. I mean, some positive stuff happened, but overarchingly, 2016, I could have skipped that one. But 2017 has lots of promise. And there's excitement, you know, even if the new president were to be Barack Obama number two, just because somebody new's coming in, there's a lot of excitement. And because this is of a different party, and there's lots of conflict, it's going to be sort of fun, too. And, you know, that's a, if you weren't convinced, like, I wonder what would happen now if we had a revote. Like, knowing everything you know today, would you still vote the same way? So whether, if you voted for Hillary Clinton, would you vote the same way? If you voted for, and I would like to see this again in maybe 6 months, if you voted for Donald Trump, would you vote the same way again? But, you know, Donald Trump might not
be the greatest. And I think he would say humbly that he probably doesn't believe it, that he's a flawed man. I think he might say that publicly he might say that he has his flaws, but he'd also say that, but I've overcome them. But I wonder if people would vote the same way. And I think maybe the margin of victory would be higher, because now we have somebody that is approaching the steps of the White House who's actually done things, who's actually done something that you can walk up and touch. Or if you're traveling to a foreign city, and I mean a different city, if you go to New York, there's a bunch of Trump buildings. If you go to Las Vegas, there's a big golden Trump building there. If you go to a whole bunch of people, if you go to Scotland, there's a whole bunch of Trump properties there. If you go all over the world, there's a whole bunch of things that this guy has built. And maybe some of the character change in the White House will be the difference between academicians and theoreticians and somebody that's actually done concrete things. And people are complaining out there. If you're one of them too, give me a shout. 803-799-8255 is the number. That's 799-TALK. But the cabinet picks all seem to be people with measured, verifiable accomplishments. None of these people are unknown quantities. All of them, you know, pretty much what you're going to get. And a lot of them are tops in the field they left. So we're going to see what it's like to have, sort of a positive corporate culture presidency, I think. I think that's what we're going to see some of that. And it should be fun. And I hope that he will have some sort of honeymoon, that will have sort of a benefit of the doubt time, and that he can move his agenda, which came with a mandate from the people, that he can move that forward and make something happen. So we'll see. And I expect it to be good. Now, the thing I asked about whether you would vote the same way today is, you know, Donald Trump might not, and he's not, be the most superlative person in the whole wide world. But man, does he pick some good enemies. Man alive, are the people that hate him so darn interesting. And there's a guy who's an internet guy, and actually he's a radio guy too. But he has a compilation of social justice snowflakes all melting down over the news that King Trumpkin would be ascendant to the presidency of the United States. And it is a scream. And you wonder, when you see these things on the extreme, like if you're an everyday person, like if you're an everyday person that I would meet or run into in a business or a professional office or something like that, if you're an everyday person and you voted for Hillary Clinton, you had reasons to vote for her. And you're, if you're a regular everyday person, I get it. My best friend voted for Hillary Clinton a long time. Rabid red meat conservative. He voted for Hillary Clinton, and I couldn't talk him out of it. And that's okay. But I wondered if he would vote the same way now or in 6 months. So that's a thing to rattle around in your head. Would you vote the same way today? And the story of the Russian hacking is another thing. And this is, I want President Obama to exit the stage on a very, very high note. If I had been his scheduler, I would have had him at the Army graduation, at the Air Force graduation, of all the Academy graduations, every positive thing that I could have put a picture of President Obama next to, I'd have him there. If he was making something a national, and there's been a whole bunch of essentially federal confiscation of land, making things national monuments, taking it off, shrinking the size of what is available to us private citizens. Well, I would have taken a picture out in front of it. But instead, he doubled down with the Clintons, and I just don't get it. I mean, if you're the president of the United States, I think you have somebody running for president of the United States who's in your party. I don't think you have a choice. I think you have to support that person. I think you would be looked down upon if you did not support the nominee or support this person running for president, and that you should have fundraisers for that person if they're not just totally despicable. But he doubled down, and he doubled down on this Russian hacking of Americans, the democracy in this republic that we, as Americans, claim we value. And so there's a reason for it. And I don't know what the reason is. If the reason is because, let's see here. I've got a message here that I can't read because of the angle that I have to twist my neck to be able to do it. But there's a reason for it. And I wonder, and it would very, very disappointing if the whole reason that the Russian hacking allegations exist is to delegitimize the transfer of power to the next guy. If the reason it exists is to undermine the new president, that would be very disappointing. And I don't want to, I have lots and lots of disagreements with President Obama. I stick him, from a safe distance while he's behind the cage of being president of the United States. I stick him and make fun of him sometimes and some of the things that he says and does and policies that he wants to do. But I want him to leave in the best light possible. And, all right, now we're gonna take a quick break, another one of these radio whiplash breaks, and be right back. I'm Gene Garris. You're listening to America's Radio Show. .com here on The Point.
WQXL Columbia, WG37BN Columbia.
Columbia's local FM talk radio experience. The Point.
Now at 100.
Moving and eating better every day can help make you and your kids healthier. Search We Can online to find out more. A message from
All right, so we have some national news for a couple minutes.
Closed. A mandatory evacuation issue as the Sierra River rises to
residents
for major flash flooding.
Not an absolute news.
ABC News meteorologist Rob Marciano in St. Helena, California. On the East Coast, the storm that brought snow and icy roads.
All right, so we've got the news going on now, and we'll be back in just a moment.
U.S. military says a soldier, part of the anti-Islamic State campaign, was killed in a non-combat-related incident in Jordan Saturday while operating a piece of construction equipment. He didn't cite any evidence, but Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu says the Palestinian who rammed a truck into a crowd of soldiers at a popular Jerusalem tourist spot was an IS supporter. 4 soldiers were killed, 17 other people were hurt. Netanyahu says there could be a connection with recent attacks in Germany and France. Richard Cantu, ABC News.
This is a test to find out if you know it all when it comes to children. Name one of the leading killers of U.S. children aged 1 to 13.
So in the interim, you're watching a great Powerade Ion.
At what age and size should a child start using a booster seat?
Don't assume you know it all when it comes to car seats for your child. Go to safercar.gov/the right seat. And know
so this
sure.
is WQXL 100.7 and 1470. Oh, a long, cool woman in a black dress. We're going to cover that up in just a moment. Crazy EDM here on The Point, which is 100.7 and 1470 AM and also 1490 AM. I forget the, I think it's DQS or DTS or something. in Cameron, South Carolina. But good to be back with maybe predictions of the future. So flag the tape. We're going to make some predictions about this year and all the neat stuff in the future. And the big thing is the United States is going to renormalize relationship with our friends in Russia, probably the largest Christian country in the world, I'm guessing. I think it is the largest Christian country in the world, and a country that we should be friends with. You know, I, as a little boy growing up during the Cold War, prayed for the end of the Soviet Union every night. Every night I did that. And thanks to policies of President Reagan and all the presidents before him that were fighting the Cold War, President Reagan actually figured it out and said, well, we're going to kick the ball into the part of the arena where we're good at and they're weak at. And much like the enemies of America are doing today with debt and driving the cost of things, we were able to break the back economically of the Soviet Union, and the Soviet Union is gone. There are probably more communists here than there are over there. And now it's time to welcome our freed friends in Russia. Now it's time to say, we're glad the yoke is off your neck. We want you to be like us, but they're already ahead of us, so in some ways. So we're going to take calls. Hey, caller, how are you?
Happy New Year.
Hey, it's David, our friend David. Happy New Year to you, David. I hope this year for you is much better than last year was for me.
Well, I hope this is a good year for all of us. Like last year, I don't think there was anything wrong with the challenge. You know, we were all tested. Some seem to, I guess, claim victory, and some seem to claim defeat.
Maybe prematurely on both sides. I think this is going to be a fight. I think everything that everybody cares about is going to be a fight. And maybe this will be like, two people at a car auction going after the same car, and the American people will be the beneficiaries of their fighting instead of the victims.
Yeah, I'm more concerned about Mr. Trump's cabinet picks than I am him.
All right, which one don't you like?
The one that I don't, well, which one? Why'd you give me, here I am yelling, I do apologize.
Which one do you like the least? Or which one do you dislike the most? Who's the worst one?
I think the one that will be in a position to do the most damage will be Jeff Sessions.
Okay, so Attorney General of the United States, former senator from Alabama, an anti-illegal immigration law.
Yeah,
he's a current senator. But he's an anti-illegal immigration hawk.
He's a racist.
No, I don't think so. I don't think so. I don't know. I don't pretend to know what's in people's heads, but I know that as a prosecutor or some attorney general-like apparatchik in Alabama, that he prosecuted a Klansman, and I know that his hate for illegal drugs and drug use was maybe overstated, and he had a quote that said something about the Klan, where he said, well, I guess they're okay if they don't support that pot or illegal drugs or something. He has a quote out there like that from the 50s or something.
Yeah, he said it was good until he found out that they, I guess, supported pot or whatever.
Excuse me.
It's un-American and so forth and so on, things of that nature. And No. We don't need that. We don't need to go there again.
I hope and I think both of these things. I hope and I think that that he is of his misquote or poorly chosen words, that he is a much better person than that would lead us to believe.
I have no confidence that he is anything more than what he has been represented as.
Okay, well, we can't see into his heart. So who's the second worst cabinet pick that you dislike the most?
I don't think this guy's, what is this guy's name, Bannon?
I think he's an advisor or something like that.
Yeah, is that a cabinet post?
Goodness, I don't think it's I think it's an administrative post, but I don't think he would be in the cabinet. I think it's like advisor or special advisor or something like that, or strategic advisor.
I really don't like any one of those people that are in a position to just take us back. I had been on a, roller coaster in a long time, but there's that loop.
Yeah.
You only want to go through once. Well, I think we're getting ready to hit that dang loop again, and I don't want to be on the roller coaster.
Okay. Well, I can see or understand the apprehension, but I really don't think it's founded. I think these people are all going to end up being top notch.
Top notch what?
Top notch good Americans. That they're going to be looking out for you and me and everybody else. They're going to do the job.
I'm going to be looking out for them. Know how to get them when they approach me. I'm going to be looking out all right. I mean, no. Gene, what is wrong? Gene, look. This is 2017. Leave that stuff back there in 2016. You know?
Well, I think we're going to do good. This is going to be a good year. This will be a good year for Americans.
Really?
Really? I mean, already we have commitments of job things. This week, Chrysler Jeep is going to create 2,000 jobs. That's 2,000 plus on this side of the line. That's a great thing.
So that will make up for at least 2,000 of the 10,000 that Macy's is going to take away. Right?
Well, I would be willing to bet that the jobs created in auto manufacturing are a lot more valuable to the local economy than the jobs created by Macy's.
Well, you tell those 10,000 people at Macy's is losing their job then.
No, that's a horrible, horrible thing to lose your job. That's a horrible, horrible thing.
But I don't know how much this approach. Well, heck, these things that are happening. These 700 jobs here.
1,000 here.
So these things, that's just showboating. They're minuscule. And it's like, he cannot do that for the next 4 years. Well, he's not going to have
it. Well, I would love it. Can you imagine if every 3 days he announced that an American company was expanding or going to put $50 billion into the economy, building a big facility. Can you imagine if every 3 or 4 days we had an announcement? One of the reasons Nikki Haley is so darn popular was that every time anybody came to South Carolina, there was a press release and frequently a picture with Nikki Haley and a golden shovel.
I don't have an issue with jobs being saved. Are jobs being created?
Uh-huh.
I just don't believe that the approach that he is seemingly taking is practical. It's like you're threatening people, you're threatening these businesses. If you leave, you try to sell your stuff here, they're going to charge you
That's sort of a neat thing, because not only is Donald Trump
This is the neat part.
So not only is he not the president yet and has no power, that's the funny thing, that he wins on the bluff, and he never has to do the fight. So it's like, hey, if you hit me, I'm going to kill you. If you punch me, I'm going to kill you. And then the person never gets punched. So he goes out there and say, sometimes it's little things. He does it in 140 characters and says, the idea that you can close an American factory and move it to another country and then still think that you're going to be able to sell your products back into America without some sort of consequence is crazy.
Isn't that what it's called, free market?
That's the deal. He doesn't actually do it. He just puts that out there, and the people are like, well, this guy's sort of a different guy. He's thinking about doing this stuff. We'd rather not have that fight. He doesn't have the power to create an instant tariff. He doesn't have the power to blacklist a company and said, you were carrier in Indianapolis, and you went to Mexico, and we're not going to accept your stuff. He doesn't have power to do that.
I believe that he does have the power to affect a change or an action.
Well, that's what power is. Power is the ability to do something that would not happen without your using that quality. So he is.
I don't believe that should be the position. That's not what a president should do.
Well, it's what this president's going to do, and this president's going to be a Twitter president, and this president is going to talk over the media, and if he can't talk over them, he's going to split them and drive through them. And I think it's just different.
Okay, well, what do you think about his? What is your take on his, if you will, giving more credence to that Assange, however you pronounce his name?
Yeah, Julian Assange is right. You know, Julian Assange is the guy that
right
put the.
What?
Well, he said, how about this? Julian Assange is the guy that has never been contradicted. He's the guy that's never had to retract a story. And he's the guy that's not running out of seconds. But we'll be right back, David, and we'll keep you here and talk about Julian Assange and the Russians.
Our website is mobile-friendly.
This magical technological age in which we live.
Load it now. MakeThePointRadio.com. Come up here, local talk radio experience. The Point.
Now at 100.7 FM at 1470 AM.
I'd like to be under the sea in an octopus's garden in the shade. He'd let us in, knows where we've been in his octopus's garden in the shade.
Even the worst Beatle is better than almost every person in popular music today.
All right, that's some happy music for a happy time. And we'll bring our friend David back up and talk to him. All right, so David, Julian Assange is the guy that runs WikiLeaks. Julian Assange is the guy being persecuted and threatened by the government of the United States of America and is holed up in the Ecuadorian embassy in London and can't leave, hasn't been outside for, you know, a number of years. But he's he's so powerful that the whole world changes by what he puts on his simple site, which isn't opinion, is just facts and copies of documents that we were not designed to see. So Julian Assange came out and said it wasn't the Russians. And a former ambassador from Britain, who was the guy that actually received the documents from the source, says it wasn't the Russians.
How can he know that it wasn't? How can Julian know that it wasn't the Russians?
Well, you know, this is a strange things. It's hard to prove a negative, so we have to let the administration prove the positive. And all these things, Clapper, who's got egg on his face for lying to the American people.
Clapper was asked a question in a setting that he should not have been asked.
Which time?
There were a lot of questions that were asked in these hearings by these supposed patriot senators, mm-hmm. and what have you, and are members of the House of Representatives. They should not be asked in open session.
Well, you know, when the when a Congress critter who has oversight over your agency asks you, are the American people being routinely listened to in all their private communications, and you lie, that's sort of a big deal. Well, anyway, so Clapper has been the chief intelligence person that's said anything about the Russians, and the evaluation of his report is that it's thin and that it's weak. So, and I haven't read it, and that's my fault.
As
I should have.
As compared to what? As compared and
the truth.
Evaluated by whom?
The truth is there are people that do nothing. You know, this is a weird thing about America and these global monster corporations, or just these monster corporations, is that intelligence of world events matters. So even some big companies in South Carolina have quasi-intelligence officers working with them, or companies that work for them, figuring out how to plan things. So there are private sector intelligence folks, and they say it's weak. So you can just Google that, and I am more likely to believe Julian Assange, who's never lied to me, versus somebody, a bureaucrat, that's demonstrably lied to me.
Well, tell me this. Do you believe that a half lie is a whole truth? I mean, a half truth is a whole lie?
No, but I do believe that if you try to push one nation state to the brink of war with another nation state, even though we are no longer equally matched, that you should have extra burden of proof put on your assertions. That before you call out the Russian president, the closest person to some sort of parity with the American president, before you point that guy out and say that he has committed an act of war against your nation state, it ought to be rock solid. It ought to be a lot better than Saddam's weapons of mass destruction.
So then, are we to say that all of our, the 17 agencies that were mentioned, they need to...
Yeah, but they're only mentioned as 17 agencies. They never break them down into CIA, DIA.
I've heard them broken down.
No, I've not heard the soup of 17 TLAs, three-letter acronym agencies. I've not heard that. And
like Air Force intelligence and Army intelligence and all things of that nature.
And
I heard it broken down today.
And it looks from what other people are saying. I haven't read it. It looks weak.
So Julian
Assange, the guy that collects all this stuff, says it wasn't the Russians. The guy that received it from the source says it wasn't the Russians. John McAfee, king of internet security, says if it looks like the Russians, it ain't the Russians. All these people I trust many more times than the government folks, the people that.
Okay,
actually,
so we're going to just go ahead and discard our.
I want a congressional investigation. If Putin compromised our democracy, if Putin put votes on a machine, if he changed the votes on a tally machine, if he swung a state.
They're not saying he changed the votes on a machine. They're saying that by
releasing the truth, it hurt the bad actors. And I don't think...
Truth.
By releasing the truth...
Half truth.
The truth. This is... Nobody has disputed any of the emails that these are fake emails. Nobody.
No, by them not releasing information that they have on the Republican.
No, that's a bridge too far. That's a bridge too far.
Not
you
a bridge too
yes
far.
It is because no. you because the question, let's say that this foreign actor did it. Let's take that position. Well, guess what? We now found out that John Podesta's email password was, guess what it was?
Password.
Password. All right. So if your 13 year old can hack the guy's email thing, it's not that big a deal.
But what's going to happen 6 months down the line when, be it Julian or Putin or whomever, gets angry because Donald Trump did not follow their directions, and then they start releasing stuff on the Republicans and
well,
or Trump?
Well, let it rain down. Let it rain down. If the Republicans are out there doing crooked stuff, let it coat them with tar, and we'll throw the feathers.
It may not be crooked stuff. It may not be crooked stuff. It's just stuff that, you know, does not shine a decent light on them.
But if it's the truth, I'd want to know it anyway. If these people are despicable,
don't want to know it.
No, I would want to know it. If these people are despicable people doing underhanded things.
Well, we know that they're despicable people.
We
don't have to read their emails to know that.
Well, you know, sometimes that would help. There might be some people on the fence.
But I think we're heading down a bad road, if we're to have no trust in our intelligence agencies, then just go ahead and
I am very confident that within 3 months the intelligence global apparatus understanding of what happened will be more in line with what President Trump thinks in those three months. Yeah, I think they're going to roll over. I think they're going to roll over, and they're going to say, it was political pressure. We were forced to do it. I'm sorry.
Really?
Yes.
You actually believe that?
I believe that.
You need to see a doctor.
No, I believe that President Obama overstepped, that he should have jumped off the Clinton suicide train at the last moment, and that he doubled down.
Overstepped. How? Please explain that to me.
Okay. So recently, the report came out, and it just came out. And our friend Newt Gingrich, former Speaker of the House, maybe somewhat deplorable on his personal life, but always reasonably consistent with his political stuff, came out and he said, look, if this report just came out now, how did President Obama make the decision to expel the Russian diplomats? And that's a good question.
I would expect that there are things that the president knows and are new prior to this report. There are apparently enough evidence without the report for the president to make it.
No, that's one thing begging the other. I think it was a report that was designed to fit the action that had already been taken. If he knew stuff was going on a year in advance, if he knew stuff was going on 6 months in advance of the election, if he knew stuff was going on a week before the election, why didn't he do anything then?
Gene, why did you ask that question? Do you actually expect me to think that you guys? You and your crew.
My crew. Let
the president get away with that.
Well, you know that we do have a House Intelligence Committee. We got one in the Senate too. If those people were given the same information that the president was given, and they said you got to go for it, then I think as a country we wouldn't have much of a choice.
And you guys would just give him a pass.
No, I think
He's going to be damned if you do, damned if you do, damned if you don't with you guys.
Oh, right? There's nothing that
he can do right.
Well, that's...
You'd rather believe Putin and Julian than...
Right now, I absolutely believe Putin and Julian more than I do President Obama. That, you know, the Boston bombing with the Tsarnaev boys? The president of Russia contacted the president of the United States and said, we got a lot of chatter going on about these guys. They're in bad, you know, there's something going on, and they're known terrorists to us, and we want you to look into it and make sure that your people are protected. So that's the kind of
president. I heard it was agency to agency.
Yeah, that's
the first time I've ever heard it was president to president.
Well, it's a government to government. It's government to government.
And now you need to specify. You can't say president to president, then back down.
Okay, government. Here we go. Let's this is desperately while I need a producer. Are you good at producing radio stuff? That would be awesome. I just, you know, you could just hang out and type all the stuff in for me. But yeah, so the Putin administration trying to save the American people. That sounds like somebody we can work with. And I think it's crazy that we have people like John McCain. How about this? Foreign policy expert. Oh my goodness, David, we're out of time. I've got 10 seconds. But John McCain, expert of failure, is on the wrong side. Catch you in 2 weeks. Be back in 2 weeks.
The only afternoon local talk radio in Columbia is the Afternoon Drive with Kev. It's all about you. It's your phone calls. It's my challenging topic. The weekdays, 4 p.m.
Wow.
Hey, what's up, everybody?
That was an error.
I love the fact that music connects to people all over the country. But unfortunately, so does something else. Childhood hunger. 15 million children struggle with hunger in America. However, the Feeding America nationwide network of food banks is able to help provide over 3 billion meals to children and families.
All right, so that's the end of that. And some of you were able to see it.
FeedingAmerica.org. Together, we can solve hunger.
And for some reason, I know I'm having
a message from Feeding America and the Ad Council.
Some signal problems, which is bizarre. So we're going to come here. And I want to cut this. There, we'll cut that down. So this was our first show of the new year. And I'm going to finish this. And hopefully, with my wild hair, you can tell it's like 100 degrees in the station. Usually, it's always much different than you want it to be. So if it's freezing outside, well, you know, it's much different than you want it to be. Look at this. All right, well, let me exit out of this, and I will catch you on the flip side. Hopefully, next video will be from Florida.